Human is.
There's a problem in the Muslim community.
And then they have to stop me and every Muslim in the entire airport?
Is it fair or is it unfair?
In general, the system is just not fair.
You got me there.
My name is Michael Sandel. I teach political philosophy at Harvard University. For me, philosophy is not just an academic subject. It doesn't just reside in the heavens beyond the world. It belongs in the city where citizens gather. Is discrimination always unjust? How should we deal with inequalities of income and wealth? Should national borders matter?
We are going to build a great border wall.
These are dangerous times for democracy. We're here in Greece at the sanctuary of Amphiaraios. Not far from here, democracy was born, and so was Western philosophy. We've gathered a group of young people from around the world, and in the spirit of Socrates, we're going to engage in some lively debates about the big questions facing our societies.
You and I, we don't have the same chances when we are born.
Can we take care of everybody?
Yeah, you can, and you should.
We need to find a way to reason together about hard moral questions. And above all, we need to ask ourselves, what is the right thing to do? Is it always wrong to base hiring decisions on factors such as race or gender? And what about at airports? Should security screeners take into consideration the ethnicity or the national background of the people they screen? Is discrimination always unjust? It's one of the toughest questions we face as democratic societies today. Aristotle said, it's easy to define justice. Justice means treating people equally. But he said, the real controversy begins when it comes to figuring out equal in what respects? That's the question of discrimination. To think this through, consider the following case. Suppose there is a retail store that wants to attract young customers, and the way they do it is to hire very handsome, attractive, beautiful sales clerks. Have you heard of Abercrombie and Fitch? All right. Abercrombie and Fitch had this policy for years. And let's assume, for the sake of argument, that it works. Is this all right, or is there something wrong with this? Hiring people, discriminating, you could say, on the basis of good looks. How many find this objectionable? Raise your hand if you think so. We've got about six or seven who say yes. How many say, no, it's okay, there's nothing wrong with this? The majority say there's nothing wrong. Why? Let's start with those who think it's okay, this policy. How would you defend it, Marletta?
Well, I would say that it's a business.
Right.
And that's what it's about. And there's other businesses that shoot for different groups of people. That's about it. It's a business policy.
Wow. I worked in a bar where it was very obvious that if you're young, female, and good-looking enough...
Good-looking?
Well, yes. And possibly was encouraged to wear shorter skirts. Then there will be happier customers. It's a bit sketchy, but our tips were way better.
Yeah, better paying customers.
It was better paying customers.
Is that why you had a hard time deciding how to vote?
Yes, because it's quite personal. And I went with it.
It's a business. It's about making money. It's about bringing in customers.
It's an added value to the business, basically.
You added value.
If that's what the customer is looking for,
yeah.
Someone nice, someone who smiles.
It's not just about smiling, if I understand.
It's not just about smiling. Not too naive, but right. Yeah. It added a bit more to the business.
All right, let's hear from someone who objects to the Abercrombie policy, Derek.
In our current economy, service jobs are king. There's more service jobs than other types of jobs. And almost every service job, you interface with a customer. And when you think about it that way, then all those jobs probably prefer better looking people.
Right.
And if that's the majority of the jobs, then the minority of jobs are left to unattractive people.
And that's unfair to them.
Yeah, it really limits their choices.
I disagree with you a bit. It sounds to me like you're saying being good looking is worth everything. Like, I mean, people can have different talents, and especially if you're in a service job, like a sales job or whatever, there are certain talents that are more important than having good looks. And there will definitely always be jobs for people who don't have the good look. It's just, it's a special talent, but they can be extremely dumb. And this is the only way for them to make money. Like, I'm like, oh, just let them have that job.
Let's assume that Abercrombie is looking at photos and deciding even whom to interview in the first place. Is that unjust discrimination?
Definitely, that's discrimination. And I also think that's not good what you're presenting to the children that coming in, because they're coming in looking at somebody's body and then they're saying, oh wow, that's hot or that's fashionable.
Right.
And then they're coming in, so
That's the point, to bring them in.
Yeah, well, I don't think that's a good example for the kids that are coming in.
Who else objects on the grounds that this is that it's unjust discrimination? Alfie, what do you think?
I don't think you can legislate against it because there's too many different... You end up getting down into kind of minutiae about who will and won't be better at their job depending on what they look like. For example, you might not be doing the show if you insisted on wearing a giant ginger wig everywhere you went. But that just is the way it is. But people have a certain presentation that they uphold.
Would you say the same about race? Suppose a company decided we will sell more sweaters and make more money if we only hire white people here. And suppose they are right about that. Should they be allowed, legally allowed, to cater to the racial prejudices of their clientele?
I think probably there's a kind of cultural and historical weight behind race that there isn't really there for people who are ugly, or whatever that word means.
So racism and lookism are not the same, not morally the same?
No, I don't think every sort of discrimination is equal.
I think they are.
But why? You think they're on a par, racism and lookism?
Yeah. I think a lot
would
of
you ban both or permit both?
I would permit it because sometimes you want to...
You would permit both?
Yes.
On the grounds that the company will be able to make more money that way?
Yes. Like, you know, you might have a certain cafe or something where you have only European, white, Aryan woman. And like, that's like the theme or something, you know?
The theme?
Yeah, that might be the theme.
The theme.
And that's why the people might go there.
All right, so, read it.
What's Hooters, your attempt? Like Hooters. But Hooters is not really based on race as much, but you kind of think of the Southern Belles over there. I don't know.
When the Abercrombie and Fitch discussion came up, I was like, oh yeah, well that's wrong, isn't it? But then I had to think back and I was like, but actually in the past, I have done that and I have knowingly done that. And it's interesting because at the moment you feel like, well, am I actually like literally so basically just selling my body out here? Or should I do that? Or should I not do that? But then I get the profit out of it. So it goes through quite a big dilemma. It's like, is that okay? Is that not okay?
Lookism, daar had ik persoonlijk nog nooit van gehoord. Ik wist niet dat het bestond. Maar het is wel iets waar ik over ga nadenken nu. En dat het ook wel een vorm van logica is. Ook als je kijkt hoe dames die in de club werken, zien er altijd op een bepaalde manier uit. En ik had eigenlijk geen idee dat daar ook echt een term aan verbonden was.
Als bedrijf wil je gewoon heel veel dingen verkopen. En als jij dat doet op een bepaalde manier, ja, je kan het mee eens zijn of niet mee eens zijn. Ik bedoel, dat gebeurt nu in Nederland ook met de Bijenkorf. Die huren ook allemaal Chinezen in om alle Chinezen te verwelkomen. Vind ik dat leuk dat ik aangesproken word door een Chinees als ik binnenkom of dat ik ze daar zie staan? Nee, want het was vroeger anders. Dingen veranderen, dan moet je als bedrijf daarop inspelen.
Who here thinks that lookism should be banned on the same grounds that racism should be banned in employment? How many would put the two on a par and ban both? Caroline, you're not sure.
I'm not sure.
So why are you
because
torn?
I'd like to say yes, because I think in basis it's the same thing. You discriminate on not the quality that somebody has, but something that they're born with, that they have no control over.
Right.
So that's my opinion. Okay, I just figured it out.
So you've decided now?
Yeah, I decided.
You would ban both?
Yes.
I think Elfie made a great point about the historical weight of behind racism. I mean, people have died because of racial hatred. And the world we live in now has been largely, especially in the US, shaped because of that hatred towards certain ethnicity. So discriminating now today against that ethnicity is just, in most cases, I would say, even a next step of that discrimination and racism.
So your position is there should be a law against racial discrimination in employment, but there should not be a law against lookist discrimination in employment.
But what would be your definition? Because that's, I think, so difficult. The lookism, like the racial issue, I think more or less can be defined quite in a binary way. Uh-huh. Where lookism, it's so subjective, practically it's not executable.
If I would hire people, I would want to have a mix of.
But can I ask you a question?
Yeah.
Okay, this may be really blunt, but should we also have blind surgeons? Because, yeah, blind people are part of society.
No,
they should be represented.
No,
in
because that's something very, very specific. That's like quite logical, I think, right? You cannot do a good job if you're blind, right?
But Abercrombie & Fitch will say you cannot sell our clothes if you do not look like what we see as the ideal of beauty.
This is fashion, though.
But that's just being looks. This is you're talking about something technical, doing something with your hands, and you have to look. That's why you need to have your eyes.
To be a good surgeon, this is an important exchange. To be a good surgeon, you say, you have to have good eyesight and manual dexterity, but then certain skills. But then Emma says, in reply, to be a good salesperson at Abercrombie, to ring up the most sales, it helps to be good looking. Why isn't that analogous?
We can change things about our looks. Our looks is... things.
It's not it's important. You can
exactly,
change something.
So, for example, Abercrombie might employ me if I'm black or white or whatever, but they want me to have a certain style so that I can fit their style. Mm-hmm. That I understand.
But we're not talking about how you dress or how you make yourself up.
If you're short and stocky, you don't get a job at Abercrombie. Even if it's your dream, even if you love their style, if you love their perfumes, if you just don't look the part, you don't get the job. So the dichotomy, I think, here is I get that they are companies and they're pressing for profits and they want to maximize their profits, so they have a style and they want to sell something. But there's an other side to it, which I think is when people walk in, what do you present as a company, part of a society, as being normal or an idea of beauty, or even, dare I say so, what is the virtue of presenting something more than just skinny white girls and skinny white guys who go, hi, welcome to Abercrombie, hi, goodbye, hi, welcome. They're like robots.
So, because I've never been in there.
Well,
it sounds like Philip has been in there.
Yeah.
But wait,
it's a long story.
But I want. So, how did you vote? Do you think lookism should be banned?
I think it's. Preferably and ideally, I would hope that companies present a more diverse.
Yeah, everyone agrees about that.
But
should
don't.
It be against the law?
Exactly. So I think you should enforce it.
Vincent, what do you think?
Yeah, I think looking at race, if you're doing that as a company, if you're saying I'm going to select on ethnicity, you're basically playing into a trend in society that that is actually morally unjust, and we want to banish that. And as a company, I think you should want to banish that, and hence you shouldn't select on that. And I think that's a bit different with lookism.
What about gender, sexism?
I think if the it depends on the purpose. Obviously, like what's the moral reason why you're allowing discrimination? And I think in most cases, if you just look at normal companies, normal offices, I think gender discrimination is bad, and it should indeed be banned.
So I do a lot of work in the disability space. Discrimination happens all the time in my community. And I wasn't as active in this conversation. I just felt like I feel like I felt too emotional to figure out how to articulate what I was really feeling.
Toen ik meubelmaker studeerde, toen ben ik ergens afgewezen omdat ik gewoon een allochtoon was. En die man zei het heel eerlijk. Hij zei, Danny, ik mag je, ik vind je een aardige jongen, want ik maakte alles de auto's schoon bij mijn werk. En hij zei, Danny, ik mag je en ik vind je een aardige gozer. Alleen, als je hier komt werken, ja, dan dreigen veel mensen om weg te gaan hier. Nou, ik wist niet wat me overkwam.
What about sexism? Should the law treat employment discrimination based on gender, should it treat it like race or like looks? You know, in the 1960s and 70s, airlines hired only young, attractive flight attendants. And they bragged about this in their advertising. Is that just or unjust discrimination?
Well,
Sharon.
Well, I think it's morally wrong, but I don't think you can stop it. And well, it's in the 60s, it's 50 years ago, so we have evolved past that.
Right. Wait, why is it morally wrong?
Well, it's a very sexist premise.
Okay.
It's sexist.
Yeah.
And
well, most of the clients are men.
Let Jeroen explain. Go ahead.
Because I'm thinking about Hollywood movies and pop stars who are all skinny and beautiful, and so it's very hard to erase that that picture that young people want to have of themselves and they want to look up to.
Right.
So I think it's the responsibility of parents and education to steer kids in the right direction.
But Jeroen, if you had the choice between two airplanes, the one with beautiful, sexy flight attendants, or one with like not so beautiful, which one would you take? Be honest.
I don't care.
The cheapest.
Ah, come
really,
on.
The cheapest.
Really don't
the
care.
Cheapest.
I would go with the one without the beautiful girls because I think they're crazy.
I think back then,
you would do that, really?
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I think their management is crazy.
I think back then, I think the airlines were focusing on men.
Right.
And on perhaps wealthy men who would like to see this woman flying him to Florida.
Exactly.
I don't think that's the thing now.
But norms have changed to some degree over the last 50 years, especially with regard to the role of women in the workplace. But what should be the role of moral judgment? Natalie and others have emphasized in Jeroen moral education. To try to change sexist norms. What should be the role of law in doing that?
We're talking about discriminating a group, and if we're talking about discrimination, as well racism, then I have to say, yeah, there should be a law to protect those who don't have that physical or that image or that color.
In the Netherlands, we have something that's called positive discrimination, where you hire people with disabilities or actually more women in the company. And I say yes to that, because not everybody has the same rights. So why can't we not protect those people who not have the same rights?
Would you protect them with a law?
Yes, why not?
Now, earlier, Vincent, you said whether the discrimination is morally legitimate depends on the purpose. So in the case of the airlines, how do you apply that standard? They say, well, what is the purpose of an airline, actually?
Make profit.
Make profit in any way? Or is it just to get me from New York to Amsterdam?
I think in the end, bottom line, it's to make profit, to make money.
And therefore, you would not prohibit them from hiring and only hiring attractive, thin, young female flight attendants? Because that helps them make money.
Exactly, that's true, unless we think as a society that's a moral, we don't want to play into that behavior of companies.
Well, do you in the case of the flight attendant?
I'm very much in doubt, to be honest. I think in this case, there could be some guidelines governing that. I think that's would be morally justified, yes.
To prevent sexism in hiring?
Perhaps, yes.
And racism?
Absolutely. I think it's...
But not lookism?
No, because I think... that's something I see more of that as a talent rather than as something that you can use to your own advantage, and that's not the case with racism. And I would.
But can't the customers just not go to that airline if they don't support it? Why do we have to coerce the business? Why can't they just not go? Just don't vote with your dollar.
Then you're playing. If we think, let's use the example of racism. Then we're playing into that racism still existing. So then that company is basically saying to its customers, it's fine to be a racist. Well, and I think that company has that moral obligation, and we all have, to banish that. But and that's why I think it's important not to put in these policies.
Well, I agree there should be no malicious, oppressive racism. But if a race is important in the image of the worker that you want to have for your customer, then that is that's a positive form of racism, you know? Racism has just become this word that everyone's triggered by. And everyone tries to virtue signal and say, oh, I don't want to have anything to do with it. Let's just put laws against it. But we all discriminate in race all the time. Like a lot of people, they don't want to date certain races. And it's not because they hate that race. It's just because it's just not their preference. So why can't these people have a business?
What if every company has a certain image how their employees
What's wrong with it?
Yeah, but will there be equal opportunity equal, for everybody? Equal, will I have this opportunity? Will
no,
she has it?
No.
Will, no, but equality but is that okay?
Equality of results is not something we want to go for anyways.
But shouldn't you have like a boundary? Like, you know, if every company has this image, how their employees
well,
should
this,
look like.
I'm not going to borrow trouble. That's not possible because, you know, there's going to be
no,
tons of different
it's happening
tastes.
A lot. I don't fit the perfect profile of a lot of companies.
Slope. Yeah.
I think when we talk about sexism very, very often in skilled jobs, it's really hard to see girls choosing skilled jobs that are majority male dominated. And it's really about education or role modeling.
I think oftentimes when we think about discrimination, we mainly focus on race and gender, but there are so many other different layers. So for example, for me, I'm a woman, I'm Asian American, I have a disability, and all of these things combined can layer on top of each other to create what is my own unique experience and my own experiences with discrimination.
Ik heb dus wel positieve discriminatie ervaren doordat ik misschien een vrouw ben in een vakgebied waar weinig vrouwen zijn. En mij heeft dat heel veel kansen gegeven. En ik denk dat ik me minder had kunnen bewijzen als ik die kansen niet had gekregen.
YMP raised the question of positive discrimination. Let's take a concrete example, the hiring of police officers. Now, suppose there is a police department, predominantly white and male, and yet the communities we police are not like that. And so we want to give an advantage in hiring to create a more ethnically diverse police force. How many think that that policy, that's unjust, that's wrong? Just two people?
I think that they should probably consider it, but they should just pick the one that's best for the job.
Well, okay, but that, in a way, that begs the question we're trying to answer. Should it be permitted? Or is it unjust? You say it's unjust.
Yeah, because I wouldn't want to be hired because I'm, you know, from a Lebanese or Arab background, because that would not give me an advantage in my work, I think.
No, so it gives you an opportunity, an equal opportunity, because you're being disadvantaged your entire life and not getting there at the police station by working there.
But eventually.
So what they do is they will give you the time to look at your skills and your competences because you're Lebanese.
I think I agree with you because I think I wouldn't be pleased to get into a surgery education because I'm a woman. I would feel like, oh, that's the only reason I'm here. But I agree with Hajar because I think that's totally right what you say. I agree, because it's a transitional period. Because now it's just the whole framework is created in favor of white men. And to raise that bar for a time, I think it would be very good, but not eternally.
All right, not eternally, Emma, but to take your example of a doctor
exactly.
Or admission to medical school, if it's predominantly a male field, is it fair to give women applicants an advantage?
Yeah, I think so, yes, because now I experience daily that people say, oh, and when is the doctor coming? The patient asking. So I think that the expectation of society, it's good to introduce such a temporary positive discrimination.
Tiffany.
Yeah, I mean, I agree with both Emma and Hajar in the sense that to be given the opportunity in the first place, that is the first hurdle. Then you prove yourself, then you become a doctor.
Especially to get women in position in the lead and also to get people of other colors, of race.
But what about the citizens that need to be served by the police officers? They need to have the best job done. We're putting them under the bus just to serve some, you know, idea of having a perfect color on the...
And I agree with you. I agree with you, but the big thing that undermines that is people not having trust in these systems, and it's because they don't have people who are representative of how they
work. Well, I agree with that. Yeah. I agree with that. I just don't think we should force the police department to have to take these applicants first. The police department should be trusted to know what's best for their community.
But they will hire people who look like them.
Because it's always white and male. It's not happening. Do you see a lot of females on the top of every company?
Because female cops aren't the same as male cops.
Do you see Muslim women being in the police corps?
Yeah, because they don't do the job as well.
No.
Because yes, they don't even think they can have the job in the
first place. Wait. Hang on.
There's biological differences.
Hang on.
I'm
serious.
Marcus's argument was...
What is important is that these communities can trust their officers, so that officers can do their job to defend them.
That means doing the job better.
Yeah. Right. Mm-hmm.
So that's a form of merit. Mm-hmm. Do you disagree?
I don't, except maybe we might disagree in this part. I think it should be recommended to them.
No, we're asking what the policy of this hypothetical police department should be.
I'm telling you.
You are the police captain.
Yes, I would definitely try it out. I thought we were saying the government would have to force the police
The police is an arm of the government.
I would try it out.
I'm a journalist in Holland, and I wouldn't want to work at a place that lets me in. Not because I'm talented or because I'm a good journalist, but because of my background. You know, we need this is a thing going on at the moment. We need more colored people in
I got most of the stuff because I'm a nice white guy to people. So why would it be any different if they do that?
Because that wouldn't make me feel good, because I worked hard to get my degree, you know, and I don't want to get into any place just because of my background. So I don't want them to pity me, you know, and you know what, you've been discriminated before.
So it feels like pity. Yeah, but my point is, I wouldn't worry about it if I were in a sense that otherwise it would go to me because, I know his dad and he's a nice guy or whatever. There's always some shitty reason that people get a chance to prove themselves. And so
I really understand you, Danny, because you have to work twice that hard to come where you at right now. But it's a form of your ego that tells you, no, I don't want the job because of my background, but me, give me the job because of my background, and I will inspire thousands and maybe hundreds of thousands of people to become the same as me.
It's not about ego, it's not about it's not about me not being a role model, working hard. It's just about them, you know, letting you in, just so that they can fill the gap that they, just so that they can fill the gap that they're missing. And that's, you know, we need somebody with a color or an Arabic background, you know? That sucks, you know?
Let YMP reply.
I really understand what you're feeling, and I really feel your emotion right now. But if I can be the next Danny, can you make that sacrifice, not for yourself, but can you do that for me? So you take the job to make it way more easier for me in the next 5 or 10 years.
That's a very good point. I don't think I totally agree with you on that, but I understand that point of view. And maybe if I'm in that position at that moment, I'll definitely think of what you just said, and I'll take maybe a different decision on that day, you know. But if you ask me now, I will definitely not do it.
It seems that Danny is making the point that being the beneficiary of positive discrimination can feel demeaning or patronized. And then YMP said, well, why not accept some of that, swallow that, if it will set an example and blaze the trail for others. And Danny was tempted by that.
He has a point, and it's a good point to consider.
Nora.
So, I think it was second year of my university course. I was, guess what, the one female engineer on the whole course. It's International Women's Day coming up. Guess who gets picked? Me. So it was definitely just because I was the one girl. So after that, I got to do a lot of outreach, a lot to go to schools and basically literally inspire hundreds and hundreds of kids about, hey, girls can do this. And I accept that.
All right, Ishan.
I think as a hiring manager, I think there's a misconception in discussion that we will hire the person with a different profile, regardless of its qualities, I would say. But what really happens in the recruitment process is really the last four. Let's say you have the last four candidates. The final hiring decision is almost never based on a quantifiable on achievements. It's always something else. And I think positive discrimination kind of gives a little push to minorities for that something else. And for myself, it's a lot easier for me to see the something else in someone who's white or maybe who's more like, who has an African background, because I connect better. But you have to, positive discrimination then comes then and say, well, wait, why not have someone from a Chinese-American background? I know you don't have anyone in your team. Maybe that's better. And I think this is the push that those communities need. We're not talking about, you know, you're number 1,001 in the ranking of candidates. You're really in that last thing and you need that last little push. And I think that's what it gives you.
Ik was super blij met de uitspraak van Philip, omdat hij aangaf, oké, ik ben blank en ik ben bevoorrecht. En als jij bevoorrecht zou kunnen zijn in een bepaalde situatie, maak er dan ook gebruik van, want het is normaal. Kijk, die uitspraak, that just made my day.
Ik ben op zich wat positieve discriminatie betreft, ben ik best stellig. Ik bedoel, je moet me niet aannemen omdat ik allochtoon ben, maar je moet me aannemen omdat ik goed ergens in ben. Maar YNP bracht een andere idee in eigenlijk. En hij zei, je kan ook als een soort van voorbeeld functioneren voor anderen. Daar heeft hij misschien wel een punt. Het is wel iets om over na te denken. En hij heeft me wel aan het denken gezet.
When Danny said about how he feels about positive discrimination, that really resonated with me. Because throughout my very beginning of my career, I was always worried whether they're choosing me because I'm the one girl between all the CVs, or is it because they are actually interested in what I do and what I bring to the team.
We've been discussing the allocation of opportunities, hiring people for jobs. The opposite side of that is profiling, is racial profiling or ethnic profiling in law enforcement. If it leads to more arrests, and if it leads to more valid arrests, is it all right for the police to pull over people of certain ethnic or racial characteristics? How many say that's unjust? And how many say it's just? Carolyn?
I think it's highly unjust. I think if you do that, then you create this circle in which you normalize the fact that you pull black people over or from another ethnic group. And I think that creates even a sort of them-us feeling that in that sense, and I'm not sure if this is true, but could even create more anger.
I always feel like the way you look mm-hmm. should not determine if I pull you over. Okay. I got these long dreads. They pull me over at every corner, but they find nothing.
Derek?
Racial profiling is a way to group individuals, but as an individual, you always want to be treated fairly just by yourself. And so if you...
Just by yourself?
Yeah.
But in all of these cases, we've found how difficult it is to identify treatment of a person just by himself or herself. So what would it mean to do policing in a way that judged each person just as himself or herself?
If you're not treated like anyone else, yes. then you immediately, you pick up on it. You're like, I've been singled out. And why am I being singled out? And I think that just completely erodes the trust, the rule of law. Like, there can be no society if you don't feel like you're being treated equally or treated as anyone else.
So that means that they should do it randomly?
Yeah. Absolutely.
Unless they have a description.
Oh.
Unless they have a description.
If what kind of description?
We're looking for a black man who killed a person.
Yeah.
And he lives in an area A. I can understand they would like to talk to everybody who's
passing
by.
But there are a lot of people who meet that description in area A.
I know.
Well, I had trouble with this dilemma. Because at first I feel like, okay, I believe in statistics, and if you say like a certain group of people makes more like crimes, then it should statistically, scientifically be okay. On the other hand, and that's why I now am on the other side of the group, I feel it makes society worse
yeah,
because
sure.
if you don't give people trust, then they'll be like, oh, you're treating me different. Well, I don't trust this society anymore. I'm gonna I'm going to make it even worse for you.
But you can't give trust without it being earned. Otherwise, trust doesn't mean anything anymore. It's just relative. So I don't think it will really have an effect. And also, I just want to say, you know, it might feel touchy-feely to racially profile someone because of their race. But if the statistics are higher, that is a specific description in a way.
Aren't these statistics a symptom of something else?
Right.
Sure they are, but that's not what we're talking about right now.
Well, we are, yes.
Yarun, finish your
point. I think giving trust to the whole community is the important thing here, and educating and giving opportunity to everyone so that you can filter out these statistics. We have to find a solution to change the statistics.
The statistic is the self-fulfilling prophecy.
Right.
So it's not a correlation. It's more an association that black people and crimes are often together. And once you start, based on that statistic, pulling over black kids more, then your statistic, your database will fill itself and it will result in a lack of trust in society.
No, because all the bad people will be taken off the streets.
No.
And then they'll see that, okay, none of these people are doing anything wrong, and then you can go back to normal.
But do you know how often they used to pull me over? Like maybe two or three times in
a
month.
I'm sorry,
No,
wait a minute. Committed crimes. So. No.
Okay. Wow. I'm just gonna kill it. Listen, for real though. I'm just gonna kill it right now, for real though. You're talking about statistics?
Yeah.
You and I, we don't have the same chances when we are born. So for you to tell, no, because of the statistics, black people do more crimes, black people don't have the same rights that you have. You are white.
All right, well,
stop it. You are white. So for you to tell me, yeah, because of the statistics, and can the black people off the streets will devaluate the crime scene, it's bullshit. Give us the same rights and just see how far we get from the same starting point.
I say
point.
We do both, okay?
No, we don't do both. No, we don't agree.
We
no,
help
not
the
even,
school, we
We don't
schools,
even agree to
we
disagree. We not even go there.
We help, you know, the welfare
you're saying that
programs
we should do
become
both.
More effective.
You mean that we should do both, that's what
yeah,
you're saying.
Yeah, we should do both. We should racially profile so that we can take the bad ones out, and then we should make the opportunities and starting points better all at the same time. Why should we not do both things that are effective? Why do we just have to pick one?
What about security checks at the airport?
Yes.
Should they be perfectly random?
Yeah.
Or
no way.
Should the screeners give more intense screening to people from certain nationalities or ethnic backgrounds?
I am always picked out of the line, and they're making me stay for 2-3
because there's a problem in the Muslim community with terrorism.
And then they have to stop me and every Muslim in the entire airport because there is a problem with Islamic terrorism?
No, I don't think every. I don't think every.
Wait, let her finish.
I don't think that's fair. It's not fair to look at a society like this. So we have a 0.01 percentage that is causing something around the world. You know what? We're picking them all, and we're going to screen them, and we're going to treat them badly because they choose for a certain religion.
It's not fair to compromise security for the citizenry at large. That's a higher value. That's a higher good to me.
I'm also Moroccan, and once every couple of trips, I get singled out, and I don't. And it's really difficult for me to say that, but I don't know if I blame the cop for doing that. They look at my passport, they say, you've been to Kenya, to the Middle East, you have a higher risk profile than the white lady from Connecticut who left the country for the first time, so we're picking you out for additional check. You know, for me personally, and I'm not speaking for any other Muslim or Moroccan or anybody else, but for myself, if the cop does his job, asks me a couple questions, and maybe, apologizes for the loss of time, then I'm fine, and I just go on.
But that's at the airport. At the car. What do you think of the cop? Because you raised your hand, and you thought it's okay to do that.
I raised my hand because I also believe in efficiency, in a way. And there was a big if in the question that was asked. So if, in the end, it results in solving more crimes, then I would be in favor of profiling those communities.
It sounds like you don't really feel you're being treated unjustly. You seem okay with that.
Yeah, and
why is that?
Because I, again, in the if of your question, if there is a threat that you're trying to stop, and
right.
I somehow fits the, you know, 6 out of 8 of the characteristics of people who have statistically committed those crimes, I don't feel it's weird that I'm asked more questions than my white neighbor.
Hisham, die ook een Marokkaanse achtergrond heeft, die zegt dat hij het niet erg vindt om gestopt te worden in de airport, want hij snapt dat wel enigszins. En hij zegt, nou, ik vind dat niet erg. Als ik een beetje het profiel pas, dan vind ik dat niet erg. Dan denk ik dat hij niet zo vaak is aangehouden als ik.
Een vorm is van discriminatie waarbij het gevoel en het geloof in de maatschappij daardoor achteruit gaat. Ik heb daardoor dus minder geloof in de maatschappij, maar ik heb tegelijkertijd wel de hoop dat ik dezezelfde maatschappij kan veranderen. En daar vecht ik dan ook dagelijks voor.
This is a topic that doesn't seem to be a dry, abstract, academic topic, this question of discrimination. As you can see from the passions that are stirred here, we've talked about 3 different debates, controversies involving discrimination. What counts as unjust discrimination in employment? What about positive discrimination? And then finally, we've debated this question of profiling in law enforcement, whether pulling over someone driving a car or pulling someone aside at the airport. Now, what have we learned here about discrimination? Caroline?
I think if the discrimination creates a more diverse society and more opportunities for everybody, I think it would be positive. And if not, it's not positive.
Back to Aristotle, he began by saying, stating the meaning of justice, the principle is easy. Treating like cases alike, treating people equally. Who could disagree that that's what justice requires? But he also said, the real controversies begin when we try to figure out alike in what respects, equal in what respects. Should the market demand give us the answer to that? Or does that simply allow the prejudices of customers to decide who should be hired at Abercrombie or at an airline? In one way, debates about discrimination are very easy. In general, most people say, we're against it. We're in favor of treating people equally. And yet, when it comes to making these hard choices and making these judgments, we are thrust unavoidably into debates about what are the purposes of these institutions? How do those purposes pick out certain aspects about us as relevant for opportunities, or for that matter, burdens and sacrifices? We have not resolved these questions about just and unjust discrimination. But I think we have, by this debate, this sometimes passionate debate, given this question a certain shape.
We just finished the debate on discrimination, and I feel really unsettled, kind of uneasy, unfinished. Like, the conversation was so passionate and so emotional.
I think what changed my perspective is understanding more how necessary it is that we have these conversations. Just hearing some of the opposing viewpoints, it's easy to sit back and vilify and say, look at this dude's opinion, this is ridiculous. But I think what you want to do, if you want to truly be effective, is to approach that person and say, hey, let's talk about this issue. You're here, I'm here. We have to get to the bottom of why you think this way, why I think this way, and find some sort of compromise or understanding to move towards a healthier place.
So yeah, I kind of just have this pent-up energy right now to want to continue the conversation.
And if you would like to join us and continue this discussion online, please go to therightthingtodo.nl and tell us what you think. Thank you very much.
Human.